And Jeff, we, if you could, get, we're going to begin the Budget and Finance Committee meeting. Okay, we'll begin with RS 2016-339, Pride, Moore, and Gilmore. The sponsors approves an amendment from the cities to cities for financial empowerment to the Mayor's Office of Economic and Community Development to implement a program designed to improve the financial stability of neighborhoods. Do I have a motion? Do you second? Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Motion passes. Resolution passes. RS 2016-340, Council Lady Dow, Pride, Moore, and Allen sponsors, authorizes Director of Public Property to purchase 13 acres for the Cane Ridge Cluster Elementary School. Do we have a motion? Council Lady Dow.
Thank you. I have, this bill accompanies a planning amendment to go with it. And I've deferred that until the next meeting, and I would like to defer this so that they both track together so that we can finish up the amendment to the PUD, the zoning piece. It's just one meeting. So I'm gonna move to defer just one meeting.
Okay, there's a motion for a one meeting deferral. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Motion for one meeting deferral. Passes. RS 2016-342, Pride, Moore, Gilmore, the sponsors, approves an adoption preparation heartworm treatment grant from the Petco Foundation to Metro Board of Health to increase efforts to battle heartworm disease. Do I have a motion duly seconded? Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Resolution passes. RS 2016-343 approves a grant from the State Department of Labor and Workforce Development to the Nashville Career Advancement Center to provide space and access applications for one-stop partners in the American Job Centers for Employment and Training programs. Do I have, Councilor, he was not here, but I'm here, so duly seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Resolution passes. RS 2016-346, Pride, Moore is a sponsor, authorizes the Metro Department of Law to compromise and settle the inverse condemnation claim of Sybil Spaulding against Metro in the amount of $265,000 to be paid out of Metro Water Services GSD Stormwater Capital Fund. Do I have a motion? And duly seconded. There is discussion, so I tell you what I'd like to do, if we would, just have Mr. Director Potter come up and start off with the explanation, then we can go from there. Director Potter, the floor is yours.
Thank you. The summary is that we did not get an easement, and we should have. We got a right of entry, and we began work, and as the project proceeded, the citizen involved in part of the project got concerned about how it was going and called to stop work to the project, engaged an attorney, litigation ensued, and it resulted in getting an easement on the end of the project instead of in the beginning. The difference in expense associated with the easements and what would be, and then the final cost, $265,000, is legal fees. So it's our mistake. We didn't get an easement, and we should have. Going forward, we will. And we won't face this, hopefully, in the future.
Thank you, stand by. I'm sure we have a few questions for you. Councilman Pulley.
Yes, I don't have anything further for Mr. Potter right now. I'd like to hear Mr. Cooper explain Metro Legal's position on this and what details you can provide us.
As Mr. Potter said, this is the result of obtaining a right of entry as opposed to an easement. In July 2014, a right of entry agreement was signed by Ms. Spalding that authorized Metro to enter onto the property for a stormwater project. It's disputed as to how much Ms. Spalding was told about the scope of the project. Once they started construction 6 months later, they started in January. Then in February, she raised an issue about the scope of the project and asked that it be stopped. She then hired an attorney, filed suit, and the basis of the claim is essentially that Metro condemned her property without paying her just compensation. Her experts claim that prior to this project, she would have been able to subdivide the property and get 4 units on the property. Now, because of the 12-foot wide channel that goes through the middle of the property, she cannot subdivide it. And so I think her experts estimate a total of $518,000 in damages. That's $400,000 in loss of value, and then the rest for attorney and engineering fees that have been incurred. So the jury, if this case went to trial, the jury would be asked to determine what the value is that that Metro essentially has taken from this property. And part of what the jury would look at is the potential use of the property, and that's where this evidence regarding the possible ability of subdividing would come into play.
Can you explain to us legally what the difference between a right of entry and an easement is?
An easement gives more definitive terms about what is going to happen on the property, what Metro can do on the property. A right of entry contemplates basically just coming onto the property to do some initial engineering type work. Mr. Potter can better explain this, and perhaps perform some work within the existing drainage area that was there. But a right of entry would not contemplate the significant structure that needed to be built for the project.
And because she didn't formally agree to this, the project moved forward. She expressed some disagreement with this project, and because she wasn't able to stop it, significant losses occurred to her ability to use her property like she wanted to, thus resulting in these damages. Is that her claim?
That's her allegation, yes.
Okay.
I would mention that this case went through mediation, and so this settlement is the result of that mediation efforts. And we had a very experienced mediator who is very knowledgeable in condemnation cases. So that's how we arrived at this amount.
And it's your opinion that this is the best course of action for us to take as a city to resolve this suit?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
Thank you. Vice Chair Wiener.
Thank you, Chair. I appreciate it. This question is actually for Mr. Potter. The difference between the right of entry and the easement. Did we have that in 2013 as procedural policy, or is that in the code?
It's more of a procedural policy that we're going to change. The right of entry allows us immediate access to the property to start work, and the easement requires more time to get. We felt like it was necessary to get going on the project. The citizen agreed, and we commenced. So we've done a lot of lessons learned analysis on this, and one of them is that we will get an easement if we go on property in conjunction with a project that has a public benefit. We're going to get an easement before we start. That way, the citizens' rights are protected, the government's rights are protected, everyone understands what we're going to do.
So in terms of the right of entry moving forward, when, under what circumstances would we look to that?
We'd have to maintain the ability to do a right of entry because in the case of an emergency, we need to have the ability to go on property immediately. Perfect example is a wastewater pipe break or something like that that has an immediate hazard to health. we need to get access to the property to fix it. And it, if it's private property, we've got to have a right of entry.
Thank you so much. That's all I have, Chair.
Thank you, Councilman Glover.
Thank you, Chair. The part that bothers me the most about this is there seems to be a pretty big variance between what their appraiser says the value is and then what our appraisers say the value is, question number one. The second question is, was the property already zoned to where it could be subdivided into four, and what kind of zoning was in place there?
As to the second question, the zone, it's R8, so it is possible to subdivide. It would be a fact for the jury to determine whether or not this property could have been subdivided to get those four lots. Their expert claims that it could be. I mean, the size of the lot, I think, would indicate that it could be subdivided.
Okay. And why such a discrepancy in value? Yeah. One says, I mean, you're talking several hundred thousand dollars. If I'm reading, land taken a value of $317,000 versus we're saying $97,000.
I'm going to ask Andrew, but I think it's because our expert did not take into account the possibility of four units on this property. Is that right, Andrew?
That's correct. The property owner's appraisal took into account the subdivision and then used comps in the neighborhood that had sold where the properties were subdivided. Our appraiser did not use that. He used different comps based on properties that were just sold and then continued to be used as single family residences. So that is why there's a major difference in the appraisal values. But our own appraiser also said that if it was feasible to divide this lot, then he would not disagree with the property owner's appraisal.
Okay, thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Director Potter. There's no other members in the queue. So we'll have a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Resolution passes. Move on to bills on second reading. BL 2016-334. Councilman Mendez and Allen are the sponsors. Amends BL 2015-1281, which authorized the Metro Department, Metro Development and Housing Agency to negotiate and accept payments in lieu of ad valorem taxes from operator of low-income housing tax credit properties. Council Lady Allen. Stand by. Let me find you here.
I'd like to move the amendment.
Okay.
And perhaps ask Mr. Jamison to explain that amendment. It's in the back of the packet.
Oh, I have, let's see. If you'd like, I can kind of mention what the highlights of it. One is to provide additional incentives, federal sponsor incentive credit, need my glasses, income credit. And the second is MDHA to have authority to negotiate up to $2.5 million in taxes. Now, that's the highlights.
Thank you.
Any discussion on the amendment? Councilman Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I see the folks from MDHA here, and I was hoping they would just comment for a moment on the usefulness of this bill to them.
Mr. Iverson's here.
So the question is the usefulness, John, or Mr. Cooper? Sure. Paddock at Grandview, 300 units, very low income, 60 AMI, under construction now. It has a combination of home money, low-income housing tax credits, and this pilot. Without this pilot, it would not be under construction. So there's your first evidence right there. And that's since we passed this bill back last August. Very useful, important to the community, preserves the value of the federal low-income housing tax credit program in our community.
Thank you. While you're here, since we're all interested in the creation of affordable housing units. Is there any estimate about how the program will be used in the years ahead?
That's speculative. I don't know. Okay. So this will not by itself generate a affordable apartment, likely, in my assessment, my opinion. It will be used in conjunction with other programs to great effect. And I think the Paddock at Grandview is a perfect example. That has state, federal, metro money in it to provide a great setting in our community. So I think that's a good example if you look at that layering.
But there's no pipeline of applications under this program.
We have an application pending right now. We've approved, I think you're aware of this. We don't approve anything at MDHA. The council does. We are essentially your underwriters. So someone applies, we analyze it, we take to our board for approval, public hearing, it gets vetted, and then after all that process, we come and Planning Commission now, Finance, will review our work, and then it comes to the council to make a decision on a resolution. So it's your program. We're part of your execution team. So, but we have one pending right now. We've approved, I believe, three. I'm almost certain of that. I know it's at least two, and that's since August. And those would not be existing. That's either preserved affordable housing or created new affordable housing since August.
There are two since August of last year.
Right. Well, and three since August of last year and one in the pipeline right now.
Okay. And that would cover how many units, the ones that are approved?
I need to take that for record to be exactly accurate, but it's on the order of 500 to 600.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilman Glover, is this on discussion on the amendment? Right. Okay.
So I want to make sure I understand the $2 million aggregate as far as the cap is concerned. I thought I heard somebody say $2.5 million, but it's actually just $2 million. Is that correct?
The amendment makes it $2.5.
Okay. And maybe I'm obviously looking at the wrong piece in here. All right. Anyway, we can move on to that. The $2.5 million is still written, though it's aggregate, so to where if you had 10 projects at $250,000 a piece, you hit that $10 million, and that's, I mean, $2.5 million, and that's, let's say, the length of time on those is 10 years. So we, in essence, we could not take anything else until that amount had been reduced. Am I understanding that correctly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Chair.
Mr. Robertson, you have something to
just
say?
Just a small point. That's per calendar year. So it's $2.5 million per calendar year as I read it. And Mr. Mendez drafted this, and I was on leave for much of this. But I believe it's per calendar year, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Seeing no other discussion for the amendment, all in favor of the amendment? Opposed? Amendment passes. Now on to the bill as amended. Duly seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Bill passes as amended. Bill 2016-342, Pridemore Allen and others as sponsors, amends the Metro Code to create an affordable and workforce housing grant program. There is an amendment to this. There are two provisions in the amendment. Basically, what they are is extending the sunset provision from 2 to 3 years, and the second one is maintaining a geographic application for new construction that applies to multi-modal corridors and within the UZO for existing properties, utilizing the incentives. The substitute removes the UZO or along the multi-modal corridor designated in the major and collector street plan, excluding expressways, freeways, and ramps. Existing developments can receive incentives as long as there is a difference in the median rents in their market and worse workforce units. So that are the two, that is the amendment, the highlights of the amendment. Have any discussion? Councilman Shulman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not on budget, but so I'm happy to defer if someone else wants to speak.
You were the only one in the queue.
The only one in the queue. Okay. Well, this is, I Yes, about, I have questions on the bill and the amendment.
This is on the amendment.
Let me, I'll tell you what, if you don't mind, let me hold, and then I'll ask questions on the whole bill. Okay, thank you.
Okay, Council Lady Henderson.
Thank you, Chair Pridmore. Can someone please speak to, regarding the amendments, why UZO was removed and multimodal corridors was removed? Was that to make the reach more expansive, or can somebody speak to that in particular?
I believe Ms. Harris could do that.
That's exactly right. We wanted to make sure that the existing, you could opt in countywide, but the new construction would be close to major corridors and employment centers.
Okay, so just to clarify, it's existing outside of those, but
that's
new.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Seeing no others in the queue. Okay, we have a request for a roll call vote tally. So is there a member of the council that wishes to request that? Well, it will be on the bill as amended, but we're voting right now on the amendment. So we don't have to, don't want it on the amendment. All right, all in favor of the amendment? I'm sorry, Council A. Henderson.
I was going to inquire who requested the roll call vote, please.
Nashville Chamber of Commerce.
Okay. I think when we do that, we should say who requests the roll call. That's, I mean, I don't know if that's a matter of procedure that we can address as a group, but I think that's only fair.
If it's requested, we'll do that because this is a new request. So we're all learning on it, but thank you very much for the suggestion. Seeing no others, all in favor of the amendment? Opposed? The amendment passes. Now we're on discussion of the bill as amended. Councilman Shulman, you're first in line again.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of questions. One is about the reimbursement process. And this may be directed to the mayor's office in terms of, it sounds like there's a, that if somebody were to apply for this, they get, in order to get funding from it, it has to go through a reimbursement process. But there's also procedure in here, the non-compliance, where they don't do what, if the people who are getting the grants don't do what they're supposed to, we have the ability to get the grant funds, I think, back. Can you explain how that whole thing works?
So it's reimbursement so that we can make sure that the units are actually in program for that year. So we would pay that, and if we find out that those units are not in compliance, then we have a way. It's just a way for us to make sure we get those grant funds back.
All right, so I guess my question would be, so why would we pay out money if we're not quite sure if they're in compliance? I understand the reimbursement process. Understand about having a catch-all provision, but we shouldn't be paying out the money through a reimbursement unless we know that they actually did what they were supposed to.
That's exactly, and one reason we've asked that the developer provide an audit each year so that we can make sure that those units are actually workforce rents, and that's how we would essentially pay it, is after we see that audit. But this happens, I guess, if, you know, mid-year we find out something, or there's some reason for us to believe that those units are not actually workforce, then this gives us some way to make sure that we can have
some
recourse.
It's kind of a catch-all to make sure that if we miss on the first go-around, we can come back on the second round. The second question is that this, the funding doesn't start in, it's not this year, it's next year.
Correct. We have fiscal year 17 or 18, I guess.
Okay, so it's fiscal year 17, 18. The money would continue until the bill sunsets. It's going to stay at $2 million unless there's some determination by the council along with the mayor's office to raise that.
Yes.
Okay. And then the last one would be, so when people make the request, it goes to, I guess, maybe the mayor's office, the finance department, it goes to a group of people to consider. Is there any type of reporting mechanism in here that keeps the council kind of on track in terms of how it's being utilized?
Not necessarily in this bill, but the comprehensive housing plan, there's a provision in there that says quarterly we will report to the ad hoc affordable housing committee as well as council on any of the initiatives, any of the housing initiatives, and this is one included.
Okay, so would this be separated out so we could actually see it, how well it's being utilized?
I'm sorry.
Okay, I'll repeat it again. In terms of the report, could it be distinguished out so we could actually see how many people are taking advantage of this program?
Yes, we expect to do an annual report every year.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilman Glover.
Thank you, Chair. The one piece that still has bothered me from the very beginning is the reimbursement piece, because we're actually, it sounds like we're putting all the burden on the development community. And I thought there was going to be a little more work done in that arena to see if we couldn't find a way to get their money back into their hands a little quicker. Was nothing ever really moved on in that arena?
We're having internal discussions about that and just trying to figure out the next steps. But for now, this is the reimbursement request is where we are.
Okay. I'm sorry. Mr. Riebling, I know, yeah.
Yeah. We hope to have some internal discussions and have, if we have any changes, we'll have them before third reading.
Okay, all right. That was going to be my next question, because I know that's what's given heartburn to some of the people that have talked to me about this. So I just wanted to make sure that we're not leaving that subject on the sidelines. Okay, thank you, Chair.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, just Can we ask for this to be redirected back to this committee on third? That way we know where we actually land on this and can have this conversation again. Would that be possible?
As a vote or as a information, what?
As a vote, I believe, because I would like to see that piece in place. And if we approve it today and it moves on third, then it won't come back to our committee again. I would just like for it to come back to the committee for discussion.
For a report.
Yeah.
And, sure, it can be redirected.
All right. Yeah, I would like to have that done, please.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't think there needs to be a vote for that. We can just automatically have it redirected.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Chair.
Councilman Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If indulging the patience of everybody here, I had a series of questions that I think would be useful for the record. And boy, do I appreciate everybody's hard work on doing this. I think that including existing stock, which in this amendment is the whole county now?
Yes, sir.
The whole existing stock of the county under these definitions is a huge step for the county to make rent, the difference between the affordable rent and market rent, a formal obligation of the county, is a huge step and worth the time on understanding the bill. So given your current definition, which just changed today, I know you may not have this information, what's the total eligibility in Nashville? How many units are currently being rented to qualified residents today?
I don't have that number. I mean, we could always pull the census information and find out how many people in Davidson County make between 60 to 120 of AMI.
But since it's median income, that's a lot of people.
It is.
Okay. What would the total liability be? I know this is capped at $2 million, but if everybody came down who qualified for this program, do we know what the total liability would be for Metro if everybody that was eligible was covered?
We do not know that number.
So how will you pick, with limited resources, from who is covered from who is eligible?
You would look at their household income and determine if you can. Are you talking about from the developer side?
Well, there are a lot of people eligible.
Right.
More than the $2 million worth of need. How do you determine who gets the $2 million?
It would most likely be first come, first serve, whoever has the units and whoever qualifies based off of that income.
So it would be jump ball, okay? Well, I'm told that the building managers are the people who Metro is relying on to do the qualifications. This is right?
That's right. The property manager would qualify.
Well, but the building owners would have a self-interest in the outcome since the owners are receiving the additional money. how would you trust the building managers to do it, one, and two, what if they're lazy managers and they're not filling out the application for the worthy residents in their building?
One thing we discussed is having maybe a landlord or property manager training so that they understand how to income qualify tenants.
How many landlords and property managers are you proposing to train?
Not sure. This is one reason this is a pilot program, and we want to test it, and okay. we want to see who will come okay. to the table.
Well, but you're dealing with real money. Does
yes.
the coverage apply if the landlord has other local, state, or federal benefits?
Yes, it can. The idea here is you would receive incentives. Most federal programs are capped at 80%, so most developments would not, if they were doing 100% AMI unit or median household income units, wouldn't have any other federal, state, or local grant okay. funding.
So it's not in lieu of these other benefits. This would be an additional benefit.
This could be one way that we could get workforce housing units,
okay.
yes.
Is there a way of directing the benefits to the most needy applicants? I mean, in a jump ball, first come, first serve, the most worthy may not be the first in the pot.
At this point, you know, we're trying to increase workforce housing units in the county or in the UZO multimodal corridor. So we would work with developers and try to make sure that we have a grant agreement in place and a developer agreement okay. that covers those units.
How are the average market rents determined? I mean, you've got a wide variety of structures, ages, appliances, terms of lease, parking, not parking, all the variations in the market. How are you going to come up with what an average rent is, and who determines the submarket?
So the developer itself, it would be just their development, and it would be the most comparable units in the building.
Just their development?
Mm-hmm.
So you're equalizing within a building itself?
Yes.
You wouldn't have one building on the street. It's what is the actual market rent in that building? For the most comparable units in that building. That's the most comparable.
If you want to speak, you need to speak in the microphone, please.
I think that's an important answer, Matt.
Let's keep the conversation where the rest of the members can hear it.
The comparable units, as it's written in the bill, are the three most comparable units in that same development. So you don't have somebody in a not great building saying, oh, market rents are this super awesome building across the street that's got a swimming pool and fancy appliances. It's the three most comparable units in the building, as determined by the developer. I mean, the city's not going to have to do that.
All right. Well, would it be appropriate to term this a voucher? That somehow Metro is giving money to make the difference between what somebody should be paying based on their income qualification and then what the market is for that specific building?
I wouldn't call it that, but
What is the right word for it?
I mean, a voucher is usually issued to a tenant. We would be providing a grant subsidy to the developer to provide workforce housing units. So
well,
I wouldn't
not not the developer to covering existing stock. You would be providing it to the building owner. And if it's existing stock, right. So it would be. So it would be a grant. Some people might call it a voucher, but it would be a grant to the building owner.
To the owner, yes.
Okay. And that's why the initial eligibility would be very large, presumably, yes. Okay. So who is deciding who's covered in a building then? If you go back to Matt's question, the voucher would cover a particular renter. It would be very valuable because that renters would cover them against any rent increase. But more people may qualify in a building. Many people may qualify in a building. It's capped to 20% of the total property tax bill, right?
Correct.
So it can't cover everybody. Who determines who's covered in the building?
The property manager would income qualify the tenants for those units.
Well, all right.
And for any of the other units, they would also qualify them with background checks and et cetera.
So the property manager checks their tax returns?
They would provide W-2s, the typical type of information that most of the time when you rent, you have to do a background check, and you have to provide some assurance that you can pay that rent. And it would be the same thing here. It's just you would look at their household income.
So the building manager is going to be responsible for testifying as to the qualification for receiving government money?
The property manager would income qualify, but then at the end of the year, they would have to provide an audit to us to say that these units were affordable or workforce housing units. We would review that and then pay them.
Okay. Well, what about the millennial that has a lot of assets but no income? Would they qualify and be covered by this?
It depends on the household income. So it depends on how many people are in that household.
All income. And
all
no asset.
Income.
There's no asset test, only an income test.
Right, it's income.
Okay.
It could be assets. You're looking at their monthly income.
Okay. Well, why wouldn't all $2 million go immediately to cover the need from existing stock and there be no money left to incent the development of new units?
That could be the case. I mean, this is a pilot, so there could be that we have an influx of existing units that come and use the $2 million. It could be a combination of existing and new rental units.
Okay. But you still don't have an opinion about the total eligibility or what the total liability would be, other than that you are somewhat arbitrarily, on a first-come, first-served basis, just cutting this off.
Correct. It only applies if there are financial incentives available.
Okay. Well, does finance have an opinion about the administratability of this grant program?
No, we are working very closely with them on putting the individual procedures in place to make sure that we can track everything, and we don't have any concerns.
Okay. What other cities have this program?
There are not many cities that provide financial incentives. They usually provide density bonuses or other types of modifications to the zoning instead of an actual incentive payment.
And so you're not naming a city that has a grant or a voucher?
There are many cities that have a voucher program through the federal government, but not necessarily
city.
Related to
right.
Well,
we're
this
talking
type
about
of incentives.
Our city voucher
there
rent voucher program.
There are not
program.
Many.
Are there any?
Not that I know of.
Okay, I think that's worth emphasizing that we do not know of another city that has a rent voucher program to cover the existing apartment stock for what is clearly a vast amount of need, because you're dealing with, at workforce, 60 to 100 per 20% of average median income, so more than the median income, so more than the average income in the county between what is affordable by income and what they're being charged. This huge difference in the market. There's no other city that we know of that's providing this rent voucher program.
Not to this degree. However, we see this as an opportunity to get as many workforce housing units on the ground as quickly as possible.
Well, how would it do that if all of the money goes to a subsidy for existing stock and it's capped at $2 million?
It's existing market rate. So if we're moving existing market rate to workforce housing units, we're increasing the amount of workforce housing units that we have on the ground, right?
Would you go over that one more time?
So the whole idea behind the opt-in is that we're transitioning market rate units to workforce. So they're already at a market rate rent, and we're saying that if you opt in to do workforce, we'll pay you the difference between that, and that way we're getting more workforce housing units, and it's no longer market rate.
Well, in economics, I think this is subsidy of price, not of supply, and that's an enormous potential liability to the city. We happen to be capping it. But how do we tell one person that they're not getting the benefit from a program that somebody else is when they are equally qualified?
We are just making sure we can provide the units. I mean,
this program in large part is modeled after our Small Business Economic Development Incentive Program, which is a first-come, first-serve program. It is a pilot program, and the thought is you have to start somewhere, and this is a what the administration views as a good way to get units on the street as quick as possible.
Well, the small business program is relatively few people are starting a small business. We all have housing needs, and if you're talking about 120% of the average median income, by definition, it's a majority of the county. And I am stunned that we cannot say how many people would be eligible for this and how many people would be covered for this, because you are assuming a liability for the county which is conceivably gigantic.
Right. We have a cap at $2 million, and it's a pilot program. We do have, I mean, we can pull the census data, and we have the amount of people that are at the 60 to 100 to 120% median household income. We can pull that information.
Okay. And so the administratability of this is all in 2.213.050 paragraph B. It's just that you shall have the authority and responsibility to develop policies, procedures, rules, and regulations. Do you have any, will you share with us what those policies, procedures, and rules, you know,
we will.
Would be? Well, why don't you do it before we pass the bill? I mean, if there's one thing that I've learned in this council, it's second reading, you better get everything straight, because third reading, it's third reading, and first reading is on consent. So I know everybody is sort of waiting for me to stop here, but I'd like to make a motion, Mr. Chairman, which is to defer this bill
second.
On second reading, and to have it back when there are more answers to this very complicated reach, new reach. It may be merited, but it can't be done without due diligence. So that is my motion, to defer this on second reading, to come back and get a lot of this material straight with us.
Okay. I was explaining to Mr. Jameson, we have a long list of council members in the queue, but a motion has been made and duly seconded. So the motion is to defer
and bring it back on second reading.
Defer how many times?
One reading.
Defer one reading and then bring it back to second reading to the budget and finance. Is there any, during this time, recommendation as far as maybe getting with the mayor's office and answering some of these?
Yes, that would be a great opportunity.
Thank you, I would appreciate that. So, Councilman Shulman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is just on the motion, okay, not on the bill. So what we were looking at was, and I can ask Mr. Jameson, as chairman of the Rules Committee, I don't believe this measure could be amended on third reading. I believe that any changes would have to be done on second reading. So I would just ask Mr. Jameson to confirm that. We were looking at the rules to make sure that if we did pass it on second, it couldn't be amended on third.
Generally, yes. Rule 15 does allow amendments on third reading for zoning matters and budget matters. Economic development incentive ordinances, but I don't know that this qualifies as such. So generally speaking, unless there's a suspension of the rules, you'd want to get the amendments on second.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, it was just to make sure it was clear, I understand what the councilman was talking about in terms of trying to get it right on second. It sounds like we need to get it right on second because we can't amend it on third. Thank you.
Councilman Bedney.
Yeah, thank you. I want to remind you all that in the past, I did get you guys to let me move forward legislation, and I did suspend the rules, and we did pass it on third reading. So that's a comment to what Councilman Shulman just said. As one of the sponsors of these legislations, I am begging you not to defer this legislation. We have been working on this for over 2 years. The people in Nashville are desperate for us to provide affordable workforce housing. We really can't continue delaying this process because people are hurting. As you guys saw at the last meeting, we had over 40 people that lined up there are telling you how much struggle they are going through. As a sponsor, I can tell you that if we need to defer on third reading or if we need to do something to change on third reading, we can do that, but there is no need to throw the baby with the bathwater. Is that I think that's something you guys say in the
it's
U.S.
Close.
So I'm asking you, please, please, please don't defer this legislation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Councilor Weiner.
Thank you, Chair. I hate to follow Councilmember Bednay, but I am. I was hoping that Councilmember Cooper would consider a two-meeting deferral instead of a one-meeting deferral for the simple reason that we have a lot of players that need to have an opportunity to sit down. Yes, we've been working on this for a long, long time. However, we have no policies in place. We have no procedures in place. There are no rules and regulations in place. We need to see all of this. We have also changed and taken this and removed the UZO. We have to have an opportunity to hear from our constituents. We have to have an opportunity to go back to our districts and vet this fully with the people that we represent. And so because of that, I would respectfully request a two-meeting deferral. Excuse me.
Councilman Cooper.
Well, I always defer to the council lady, and I will change my motion to go to two meetings. Time goes by quickly, and that may be more appropriate for the size of the work at hand, given that this is an unprecedented program for any city in America. For us to be passing this on second reading at this point, where third reading amendments are in question, I think the prudent thing for us is to be very careful in going forward.
Thank you, and I do appreciate your candor on this. However, this has been ongoing for quite some time, and a lot of these questions could have been answered since prior to today. But I appreciate. Thank you. No,
just that this particular bill has not been published and out. I mean, there are changes as of this morning that are material.
The amendment, which we brought before members, and there was no discussion on the amendment, so. Council Lady Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just like to say on the amendment, I feel like an awful lot of work has gone into this. We do have 3 weeks between the next meeting, not two. And also that I don't feel like because we can't serve the entire city with this unless we have a totally open-ended obligation, which I think is inappropriate, that's not a reason not to do this. And we have very carefully put a cap on it at $2.5 million. And so I think while there are still conversations to be had and we may have room to make some improvements, we continue to talk with the stakeholders and the business people, and they've thrown some ideas out, nothing that we were ready to deal with at this point. But I feel like we've come a long way. As you say, we've been working on this a long time, and I think we've got 3 weeks to continue to do things. I would trust that this group would be willing to suspend the rules on third reading if we had great things to improve with it, and that if we don't, then they can trust us to defer at that point. So I would vote against a deferral.
Thank you. Council Lady Gilmore.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I wanted to also thank my colleague to the left of me, Councilmember Cooper at large, for bringing forth his ideas. I was on the last council, and we have put quite a bit of time in it. And I think the question becomes, just because you put quite a bit of time in it, does it make it a good bill? And I feel like it's a good bill as well, because there were a lot of meetings, and there was feedback, and the bill has changed. So I think that speaks to the work that has gone into the bill that has made it an adequate bill. As the point of it being done in other cities, my question is, why not Nashville be the first city? Why do we have to wait for other cities just to give us the go-ahead? We have a need here. I think Councilmember Bedney said it eloquently. There's a cap on it. There's a serious need. And Nashville could be the first one. And if it doesn't work out, guess what? We have a sunset provision on it. And I don't think that we'll ever be able, most of the time, in most cases, whatever you do, nothing is totally all or nothing. And we know that as elected officials. There's a little bit of compromise. There's no way, even with the best bill, that we would be able to help all 100% of the people that needed the housing. So I don't think that that's a realistic expectation. However, I do think some of the other questions that were brought forth by Councilmember Cooper are willing. I think Councilmember Allen and Bedney and Mendez and myself are flexible, and we look forward to working on those things. But I think the bill should go forward. And so I am on the Budget and Finance Committee, and so I would not be supporting a deferral. So thank you.
Thank you. Council Lady Henderson.
Thank you, Chair. My question's been answered. I apologize.
Thank you. Councilman Glover.
Thank you, Chair. I think because of the confusion with regards to our rules, can it be amended, can it not be amended on third? Suspension of the rules, yeah, we may say right now that we would all agree on suspension of the rules. I would feel better personally, and I'm going to support the deferral because I think we need to get some of these questions that Councilman Cooper has asked. I think they're very important questions that need to be answered in full. And some of this amendment we did just see today, and I realize we passed the amendment. I got you on that. But I still think that there is some work that needs to be done. So I'm going to support the deferral. Thank you.
Thank you. Seeing no others in the queue, is there any member that on the Budget Committee that wishes to request a documented tally of votes? I'm speaking for the Chamber of Commerce. Do we have anyone? Okay, Councilman Glover. In that case,
still on the deferral, so you may want to take a vote. Allie, if it doesn't.
Okay. Now, I think the motion is now a two-meeting deferral. Is that right, Councilman Cooper?
It is.
Okay. All in favor, there's been a motion and seconded for a two-meeting deferral. All in favor of a two-meeting deferral, Budget Committee members, raise your hand. All opposed.
Okay. Sorry. So motion fails.
Motion for two meeting deferral fails.
Are you on the bill as amended?
Now we're on the bill as amended. Again, we want to take a documented vote. So Budget Committee members only. Mm-hmm. All in favor of the bill as amended, raise your hand.
Keep them up.
And please keep them up until we can get it. Okay, thank you, council members. All opposed, please raise your hand. I count four. Please keep them up. Councilor Dow, are you raising your hand? Okay. Well documented. Okay. Tally is?
Against six, against 5-4.
5-4, six against for approval. So that is the Budget and Finance Committee's recommendation. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the last item on our agenda. Budget Finance Committee meeting is over.